The Indian cricket team played extraordinarily well in Ahmedabad, like the Girline. And they tumbled down, you know, without a spine in Bombay. And even before they go to Calcutta, they are fighting. So it must be doing, got to do something with all these places. I am blessed in a way that Dr. Swamy, Vaidyanathan ji, Guru Murthy ji all guide me personally. So that's why I am here. I've been given a very interesting topic, FDI, FII. And they have left no adjective, no adverb, nothing. They speak about FDI, FII. So I said, thank you very much. You know, three words as pinned us down in the last 60 years. We are like a deer in front of a headlight, you know, oncoming vehicle with a dazzling headlight. First 20 years socialism, second 20 years secularism, third 20 years globalization. That's all. Three words have pinned us down and we are completely frozen. On the globalization part, the FDI, FII makes a very important subset. The whole idea of FDI, FII begins with somewhere around 94, 95. Of course, liberalization started, but they started making some more reasoned documents. And that idea primarily came from one Punjabi and one Bihari. See the combination. I won't name them. And the idea was simple, that India required to grow at 8 or 9% to come out of the entire poverty. If Indians are to be lifted out of poverty line, we required 8 to 9% growth. But India had enough capital only for 6% growth at best. So the balance 2% growth need to be funded from outside. And that's why we require FDI, FII. But what is the truth after 20 years liberalization? As Mr. Gurumurthy pointed out this morning, our savings rate has gone up from 18% to 36%. The last 20 years. Even yesterday somebody was asking me, sir, you know this huge amount of expenditure in India. Nowadays we are spending too much. If our expenditure has gone up by 2x, savings has gone up by 4x. In fact, we are saving more today. Household savings has actually gone up more, as Mr. Gurumurthy demonstrated this morning. That means we have 36% capital our savings, and with an incremental capital output ratio, that which converts savings into investments and investments into growth, is 4, and 36 divided by 4, you get 9%. It is not Mr. Chidambaram who has done it. It is not Mr. Yashwant Sinha who has done it. It is the lady in the house who has been able to save, and this saving has gone into investment, and this investment has to grow. On August 6th, 2011, the US was actually downgraded. Because many of you may know that the Standard & Poor's downgraded it by a notch. It was a Saturday morning and Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, was the finance minister, was going for some CIA or FICCI meeting. He was asked, well, there is a crisis in US, the US dollar has been downgraded, US has been downgraded. How do you see this crisis panning out in India? He said, the fundamentals of Indian economy are strong. What does he mean by the fundamentals of the Indian economy? He means the household saving. US may be there, US may not be there. I daily tell myself that euro is in ICU, ICCU, and dollar is in ICU. And I'm sure many of us who have heard Professor Vaidyanathan speak, both these places are going down by the day. And what Pranab Mukherjee says is, we have tried so many taxes, so many things, so many screwed up policies to bring down this household, but yet this household is surviving. That is why he says the fundamentals of our economy is strong. It is not the government of India's balance sheet is strong, it is the fundamentals of the Indian economy. That time they go to the fundamentals of the economy. So we are saving at 36%. And that 36% divided by a factor of 4 gives you a 9% growth. Everybody is happy. Now you change section 80 IA B 2 subsection clause 3 in a budget, and we chartered accountant break our head. This has not brought the change in India. The macro level change of growth in India is because of the savings. Now you can still make it more. To 12%. How do you make it to 12%? You increase the incremental capital ratio, that is the efficiency in the economy, from a factor of 4 to 3, and 36 divided by 3 will give you 12%. That requires reforms. What is the reforms that it requires? It requires that you should show spine in clearing off encroachments in the Pampa Mahakavi Road. But people who cannot clear encroachments here talk about clearing encroachments of Chinese in Arunachal Pradesh. And they tell us that they will do this, they will do that. And it's very easy to say FDI in retail, FDI in pension, FDI in that, FII will increase. All these are very nice. But the truth of the matter is that we do not have, world does not have money to give you. All the countries are going down. And even if they have money to give it to you, it is only so marginal that, as Mr. Gurumurthy said this morning, that 98.2% of the total investment requirement of India has been funded by Indians. And balance 1.2% is like a pickle in a Madras thali. You may have it, you may not have it. But you know what we have done? We have converted the pickle into the main dish. And the main dish into the pickle. And 98% of the media space has been taken over by this FII, FDI investment debate. So, first thing, we must turn the debate upside down. The debate is primarily, as the Goldman Sachs document 187, he pointed out, that the entire funding for the next 10 years of infrastructure development predominantly comes from India. There is another dimension. The balance 2% which is there is not FII. FII stands for foreign institutional investment. I call it foreign indirect investment. Let me explain. Mr. Kejriwal came out with some startling expose. Last 10 days he is missing. I don't know why. I think he has taken some break. And like every weekly, used to come and give some papers, and one of the papers made some very startling revelation, not for what he said, what I always already suspected, and there was evidence on some documents. The latest one was on HSBC. The HSBC story is very funny. Two employees in Zurich, HSBC, steal some data in some CD and migrate to France. And in France, they are caught by the French police. They send back to Zurich. But the CD is retained by France. A duplicate is made out and handed over to the French police. And that CD contains names of around 120,000 people and corporates. And if you sift the various cross-holding and the thing, there are 79,000 names, of which it is believed 700 are Indians, prominent Indians. And that is why perhaps it is a remarkable coincidence we signed the deal for fighter aircraft with the French. That is a different thing. Perhaps it is a coincidence, perhaps it is a genuine transaction. God knows. Now what happened? This 700 came to our people and our people kept it quietly. They said we will collect some taxes. I know once the names are there, they would have gone and settled. There is a provision called Settlement Commission in the Income Tax Act, where you have to settle through payment of commission. So this particular document that Kejriwal gave was very startling in the sense that three people of the 700 odd were raided, and three of them had given a statement to the income tax authorities when the raid were going on. The reading them made my my blood was boiling for a simple reason, that all of them had so much of money that as if they were having some pocket change. One man had 5 crore 5 lakhs in his house. He was asked to explain the source. Where from you got this 5 crores 5 lakhs? He said, 5 lakhs I will explain the source. But for the 5 crore, one gentleman came, I don't know who is he, gave me cash and he said he will buy my house. I don't know, I have not even entered into an agreement. He has gone back and he has not come at all. And I will pay taxes for this. This is how they have 5 crores in their house. But the comical portion is not this. The more important one is, according to all the three of them, they said, we dialed one number in Zurich. And that number was of some gentleman there. And he would immediately send somebody here. They would collect this gunny bag of 5 crore, 10 crore, 20 crore, whatever we gave them. And immediately this money was getting credited in Zurich. We could credit it in any currency we wanted, dollar, yen, euro, anything. And whenever we wanted to make some transaction out of that, we could do it. And whenever we wanted Indian rupees in India, it was delivered. And so Kejriwal made a very sensible statement for once. He says, it is easy to operate this HSBC account in Zurich than SBI account in India. But there is something more into it. I was following this HSBC for a very long time, but I thought I should do some facts and bring that before us. HSBC's current CEO says the previous CEO is the world's greatest launderer. Not me, not Mr. Swamy. The current CEO accuses the previous CEO. Jersey, which is a tax haven, is conducting an investigation on HSBC. I don't mind Mr. Swamy calling me bad. But if Ibrahim Dawood comes and tells me I am bad, look at what is my state. That is HSBC. It has problem in UK, it has problem in Jersey, it has problem in India, it has problem in America. All across the world it has problem. But HSBC is put under enormous amount of scrutiny all across the world. But in India, Governor RBI is silent. Finance Ministry is silent. Almost 1 month since this revelation has happened, not a word from the Finance Ministry. Now, if money can go out and come in this fashion, which all of you know is called hawala in simple terms, and then it gets laundered, and laundering, you actually clear the illicit money from the dirt associated with the money and present it as clean money. That is why Dr. Swamy was referring to Mauritius. Once it goes to Switzerland, it comes to Mauritius, and from Mauritius, through the participatory note route, it comes and enters India. In fact, Dr. Swamy, Mr. Vaidyanathan, Mr. Gurumurthy are only three people who have spoken about participatory. Even people have not spoken for it. Forget against it. Now, why Mauritius? Mauritius and India have got a very funny double taxation avoidance treaty, which the Honorable Supreme Court found it to be a honorable one. And according to that treaty, any investment made from Mauritius into India in shares will not be taxed in India, but in Mauritius, where the tax rate is zero. So, you know, the largest investor of FDI into India is not US, not Japan, not France, not Italy, not Germany. It is Mauritius. And as professor said, it is not even the entire Mauritius. Not even a city, not even a road, not even a mohalla. One building, one room, lock and key. And they all have the same receptionist. That you missed it out. Sarve jana sukhino bhavantu, sir. Now, this Mauritius route has been abused so much. Supreme Court would not understand this. Supreme Court said, oh, how can we look into Mauritius thing? Mauritius people, if they give you a certificate of residency or something, that should be taken. It is easier to buy that certificate in Mauritius than to buy a ticket in the local bus.
Yes.
You go there, they will give you. You don't have to bribe. Bribing is not there. Nothing. I am going to do bus. And it is so easy to establish this. And in our country, RBI is supposed to confess that $18 to $20 billion of money goes out of this country to the Hawala route. $20 billion. And this the US State Department quotes in a narcotic strategy control report and tells year after year India is one of those areas. Why the US is bothered about India? Because India has emerged as a center for financing terrorists. They are not bothered about your stock market and other things. They are bothered whether your dollar is going to hit them through some fanatic. They are monitoring India. They are looking at India as a very serious place, a conduit for laundering wealth, and they are monitoring whether India is putting all this illegal wealth and that transfers into your financing of terror activities. Frankly, as a chartered accountant, I will tell you, it is very difficult to monitor this unless the state steps in a very, very draconian fashion on those criminals who are practicing money laundering. But when in a country where the ministers are doing this, in a country where politicians are doing this, in a country where a reputed bank, international bank is supposed to do this, I am not even bothered about HSBC doing it. I am only bothered about the silence of the finance ministry. I am bothered about the silence of the RBI. You know, in chapter 2 of the Gita, Bhagavan describes the immortal soul. He says, weapons cannot cut me. Fire cannot burn me. Water cannot wet me. Wind cannot dry me. This hawala money is something like this. Commissioner income tax cannot touch me. Enforcement directorate cannot give notice to me. RBI cannot question me. SEBI will not know anything about me. So we all live in a very, you know, suspended sense of disbelief that all is well, all is well. Professor acted in that movie. He comes for a scene. In that movie? Three Idiots? He's not derailing. I don't know. Sir, we are in Bangalore. Lot of students are there. Let us go up safely. Now this money laundering issue has become so serious that commodity markets gets destabilized by this money that comes in, illicit money. And the worst part is we have not even transformed this illicit money and canonized it as if it is some Allah, Buddha, Christ all rolled into one. We say it is FDI. And you know the way the channels speak about FDI, it's such great reverence. As if, you know, red carpet and all those things, nobody realizes that it is 1.5% and half of it is your money, damn it. The moment this is told to the pink papers, the editors will stand naked. Editors don't know this. Editors think, and in fact, I used to think that India was requiring great amount of foreign money to propel us, till one day in a station, the train was delayed and I had a 1 hour long discussion with Mr. Gurumurthy. If Buddha had the Bodhi tree, I had Dindigul station. And in 2007, RBI comes in its annual report in a very succinct manner and tells more or less the same thing, adjusted for a few decimal points here and there, that foreign direct investment in this country, when I say foreign direct investment, I also include the foreign institution, the foreign money, I will put it this way, is a small fraction of the total investment that is available in India for investments in India. If only this particular thing is taught to our polity, our judges, our corporate leaders, our media people, you know, the psychology of India will itself turn. We will stop looking ourselves as a beggarly nation. We have entrepreneurs, we have capital. And when we have entrepreneurs and capital, this whole damn game, as professor says, don't mess up with us, has more meaning. It is not bravado. When professor says, don't mess up with us, we have got entrepreneurs. China cannot build up, howsoever crooked he may be, they cannot bring up one good entrepreneur of the type that we have today. Can China have a Ratan Tata? Can they have a Narayan Murthy? They can at best have made in China. They can't have made in Infosys. You have to understand that. And that comes out of a civilizational perspective. That is the strength of this dharma. That is the strength of our family values. That is all integrated. And you cannot take a hair out of an elephant, transplant it on the bald head of a man, and say he's a bear. This is what we are trying to do. This particular, you know, hit and scoot media is distorting the debate. The debate is far too serious today. We have a model, we have a functional model, we have a very, very, you know, we are a 5,000 year old model minimum on which entrepreneurs survive. Entrepreneurs survive on domestic capital. Domestic capital survives on family values. Family values is sustained by a sense of responsibility with entrepreneurs. It is not the Goldman Sachs variety that you take one commodity to the extreme, drop it there, then take the next commodity, drop it there. No, it is born out of an enormous amount of responsibility. But that is the model that is being talked about. And so, stock market is not as I think Mr. Gurumurthy said this afternoon, it is no longer with us. It has gone to the hands of the foreign players. Commodity market is no longer with us. Real estate market is no longer with us. This is all being taken away. Brick by brick. And wherever it is there, even when the other countries want to invest money, we say the white man has to give us the route. And only the white man is welcome. And that is creating enormous amount of distortions in our foreign policy also. We are unable to treat the world the way a responsible civilization has to be. So, I will conclude that we are in a situation where one need not be opposing mindlessly this FDI. We are not Marxists. Marxists are like a clock which has stopped functioning, yet it will show the right time twice a day. So, you know, we are not like that. We don't want to oppose everything. We like to have cross-fertilization of ideas, capital, entrepreneurs, technology. We are not afraid of anybody. We will defeat them not only in India, we will defeat them abroad. If at all last 200 years have been an aberration, 1,800 years of history is a testimony to the fact that it will dominate the global economy. As Professor drew reference to the Uttarapada speech of Aurobindo, he says, on the ruins of the West, India will rise. We are seeing the ruins of the West. We are also seeing India's rise. No two opinions about it. But it is the mindset which I think Dr. Swamy spoke about in the morning. It is not an automatic one. It is not that India's rise is something that you are sitting on an elevator and take you up. We have to fight our way through. Fight our way through with our ideas, our ideals. It is to impose on us, on the world, and tell them, look, we are having a model. We are having a functional model. We need to take the world and educate them. They are still 5,000 years behind us. They will take time to catch up with us. We have to understand that. We have to teach certain things to them. And it is this particular problem that we are all having a challenge before us. That the world is crumbling is an opportunity. But India is not rising enough is a challenge. We are in a very, very difficult times, but interesting times. 30 years from now on is going to be the most interesting and the challenging times. That we will have to tell the world that we follow the Indian model. Because as I said, communism is almost over, except one or two you may find, like the extinct birds, Sitaram Yechuris and the Karats will be available. That shows once upon a time that the communism was on. And capitalism of the Western variety, which is of such crass nature, it doesn't have responsibility and it has only profit maximization as the only goal. That also has come the whole circle. That also is collapsing. So we have to, economics as a discipline is collapsing. Economists are not, economics, they say global economics is in crisis. I say no. Globally, economics is not in crisis. Globally, economists are in crisis. Because whatever theory that they said have been debunked, have been proved wrong, have completely been negated, and negated in their lifetime. And they themselves are confused. They themselves are saying, we do not know what has happened. And that includes Dr. Manmohan Singh also. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'll conclude by saying only one thing. That please, when somebody says FII, FDI will be the chief drive of this country, of this economy, challenge them on facts. Because we need a million of us to challenge them on fundamental facts. Two, we need to tell them and educate them. We have a responsibility. And this doesn't mean that immediately we start abusing them. We also start telling them, look, whatever you're saying is wrong. Here is the RBI report. Here is the paper written by so-and-so. Here is the facts. Here is the figures. Now you tell them why it should be like this. This is a very important war where we cannot lose our balance. The other side can afford to lose their balance. We cannot afford to lose our balance. We have to be very, very sensible. We have got a responsibility as a civilization. Please understand, whenever you tweet, you don't tweet on behalf of yourself. You are tweeting on behalf of a civilization. You are representing Dr. Swamy also. So you have to be very careful that whenever you do that, you are putting both the facts and the manner of presentation is absolutely acceptable to the world. Thank you. On August 6th, 2011, the US was actually downgraded. Because many of you may know that the Standard & Poor's downgraded it by a notch. It was a Saturday morning and Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, was the finance minister, was going for some CIA or FICCI meeting. He was asked, well, there is a crisis in US, the US dollar has been downgraded, US has been downgraded. How do you see this crisis panning out in India? He said, the fundamentals of Indian economy are strong. What does he mean by the fundamentals of the Indian economy? He means the household saving. US may be there, US may not be there. I daily tell myself that euro is in ICU, ICCU, and dollar is in ICU. And I'm sure many of us were, I said, thank you very much. You know, three words has pinned us down in the last 60 years. We are like a deer in front of a headlight, you know, oncoming vehicle with a dazzling headlight. First 20 years, socialism. Second 20 years, secularism. Third 20 years, globalization. That's all. Three words have pinned us down and we are completely frozen. On the globalization part, the FDI, FII makes a very important subset. The whole idea of FDI, FII begins with somewhere around 94, 95. Of course, liberalization started, but they started making some more reasoned. The Indian cricket team played extraordinarily well in Ahmedabad, like the Gir Lion. And they tumbled down, you know, without a spine in Bombay. And even before they go to Calcutta, they are fighting. So it must be doing got to do something with all these places. I am blessed in a way that Dr. Swamy, Vaidyanathanji, Gurumurthyji all guide me personally. So that's why I am here. Been given a very interesting topic, FDI, FII. And they have left no adjective, no adverb, nothing. They speak about FDI, FII. So, the last 20 years. Even yesterday, somebody was asking me, sir, you know, this huge amount of expenditure in India. Nowadays, we are spending too much. If our expenditure has gone up by 2x, savings has gone up by 4x. In fact, we are saving more today. Household savings has actually gone up more, as Mr. Gurumurthy demonstrated this morning. That means we have 36% capital of savings, and with an incremental capital output ratio, that which converts savings into investments and investments into growth, is 4. And 36 divided by 4, you get 9%. It is not Mr. Chidambaram who has done it. It is not Mr. Yashwant Sinha who has done it. It is the lady in the house who has been able to save, and this saving has gone into investment, and this investment has to grow. Documents. And that idea primarily came from one Punjabi and one Bihari. See the combination. I won't name them. And the idea was simple, that India required to grow at 8 or 9% to come out of the entire poverty. Has, if Indians are to be lifted out of poverty line, you required 8 to 9% growth. But India had enough capital only for 6% growth at best. So the balance 2% growth need to be funded from outside. And that's why we require FDI, FII. But what is the truth after 20 years liberalization? As Mr. Gurumurthy pointed out this morning, our savings rate has gone up from 18% to 36%.